Hello. And damn, the way I'm Galio, your PC sounds amazing.
Good.
I want a spaceship PC instead of a PC from the last. Well, it was new a while ago, like 7 years ago.
Yeah, 7 years ago.
It's fine, right? As long as it still literally functions. Okay, I'm gonna do the paint in the dojo.
Oh, fuck.
I wonder if I should make like a dojo roll so we don't ping like
Nah,
every.
pick everyone.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, people are
everyone.
People can always mute the channel if they don't want to get pinged, right? Pretty
Yeah,
easy box pings.
people have a tendency to just mute the entire server, which
You
isn't.
can, I think you can mute separate VC, I mean, not VC's text channels.
I mean, you can, but people just mute the whole server, so.
Unfortunate.
Then again, you'd have people who are interested in watching but won't get the role. I don't know, man.
Yeah, exactly. That's this is a more. There's
Not
a
worth
everywhere that.
opening again. Right, I'll invite.
All right.
Hey, Spaniel, when you check all I know you do like frame checks and stuff all the time. How does that work? Like, do you have a tool that you can do it with, or are you literally just like time recorded videos or something?
Yeah, mostly that. I'm just gonna quickly do this ping, and then I will Right, about to
have a
mention.
setup. We'll just wait for people to. Oh God, here we go.
Yep, here we go. Yeah, so I think we're going to talk today about peel and just kind of like
Yeah.
about what you need to do to make it happen and the concept of P. Yeah, dosing and that would be peel. Yeah. I mean, it tends to just break the entire lobby, doesn't it?
Yeah, we'll figure it out. I have a good idea of what we should talk about.
Awesome. I'm looking forward to it. Coach Normie is in the house.
Solo coach today.
Teacher Normie, you're sensei. Now you're today you're sensei Normie. Add the role to you.
I am a sensei today, yes.
Yeah.
Evening.
Peel.
Good evening.
Potato hands again.
Yeah, hello, Spile.
Doing well.
Considering peels, I'm pretty sure I know this, but I'm just curious to see if I don't know anything.
There's always more to learn.
Upspun.
Hey, Emily, how's it going?
Hey. Yeah, nothing can stick in. I'm going to peel myself right now, but
Is
have a
all the
good
four
night.
considered a peel?
Yes, definitely. Also an option select.
Yeah,
Oh
all.
yeah, okay, good. I should use that every mission.
Yes, all the four option select is
You do
deadly.
you're in the streaming today, normally, aren't you?
Yeah. Which I'll do right now.
Don't understand how these crazy things work. Did we need four of us for this, or are we just gonna
Oh,
go?
we can do three. We can do three. It's fine. We can just switch around if needed. I think we might need four at some point, but
I
we'll
can
get
be
someone.
it can be the fourth if you want.
Yeah, there you go. We'll have someone around.
All right.
Though I all gonna need to go to the toilet at the moment. I'll probably be back in 10 minutes, but y'all can start without me.
We'll
Obviously.
give it like 3 more minutes for people to
Yeah.
get around.
When are you gonna start the whole pill session thing in 3 minutes?
Yeah, we're just waiting for everybody to get in the VC. If there's people just still looking for the pink.
Yeah.
Thinking with start off with not really straight into build, but with more about hitboxes and place and character placement positioning. I mean,
yeah, that's really good.
We can start this. Right, so, Spaniard, you're going to be on my team. And them on the other.
Damn, the Greg today.
Pick, like, Warlord Spaniards, and them, it doesn't really matter.
Always different in the pinball one. Greg. Yeah, Warlord is well known as one of the characters with absolutely great peel. I guess we can start off. Well, I'll let Normie take the lead if you want to define the term peel before we get into it.
So, peel. You've probably heard it around. You might have even watched some scrims on Twitch, whatever. People screaming. Peel, peel, peel. Other things like that. Peeling is basically peeling your opponent off your teammate, saving him from eating a bunch of damage. So right now, we have, before we actually get into it, it's different with every character. There's characters that have great peel, characters that have okay peel, characters with no peel. For example, Zanthu and Warlord, which we're playing right now, are two of the best characters for peel in the game. Which is why you're going to see a lot of them in 2v2 tournaments, 2v2 scrims, because that's kind of what Twos is about, peeling for your teammate and other stuff like that. So, how do I say this? For example, every character has the best tool for peel. So Kensei used to be the best for peel in the game because of his sidelights from neutral, which had like insane range and were incredibly safe with no recovery, no anything. And plus it was a chain starter, so he could just, if you tried to GB the recovery, you'd get hit with a, what, like 27 damage heavy. So there's obviously scenarios where you won't want to peel, scenarios where you can't peel because your enemy has Venge or stuff like that, which is stuff you need to learn and get used to over time. It gets pretty simple after that, but there you go. So, for example, if them GB Spaniard and wants to charge him forward, I'm going to peel by getting him out of it before he gets his punish. It works like that with whatever. Guard break of your teammate getting bashed, your teammate getting guard broken, you're like, guard break can do his own.
Or if, yeah, or if them parries my heavy.
It's preferably do lights to interrupt better, easier to interrupt.
Lights are better pick because obviously they're faster and sometimes they even have a bit more range, like with Kensei. Zone attacks, Kensei's zone attack, Zanhu's zone attack is, I'd say probably the second best peel tool in the entire game because it has so much range. So if I'm here, them GB Spaniard, I go whatever. Like,
yeah,
there's dodge forward lights, whatever you have. Obviously, you're not going to want to peel with like a 1 second long Highlander heavy because your teammate's going to just eat damage.
Yeah.
And the guy you're trying to peel off might even have short enough recovery to block your attempt at peeling. There is
Yeah,
go ahead.
To a certain extent, when you're close to, and then this is what makes ganks very, very different, when you're close to your opponents, you know, you can peel with any character just using your basic light attacks. In most scenarios, you know, if Dem gets a guard break on me, you know, normally doesn't have to use his zone, he can just poke him with a light attack, and that's going to work in this situation. But when you're in team fights where you have to be moving around a lot more, then the peel tools essentially come down to which things have the biggest range and the biggest hitbox and the safest from being counter-peeled, as it were. So, if, you know, if it, maybe Normie's got a really long forward range attack, but let's say like Warden's forward dodge heavy goes a very long way, but it's got not the best recovery on it. So whilst it's a good peel tool to interrupt, if Dem's got another ally next to him, then the interrupt attempt can be punished as well. So you end up with damage going down the chain, as it were, so I'm the one who originally gets punished with a guard break, but Dem eats the interrupt from Greg, and then Dem's ally will punish Greg as well. So it's a lot about, in team fights, you really have to be thinking about them as team fights, and this is the main reason why people play team modes a bit more than the 1v1s, because there's just a lot more to think about, because you've got to be thinking about of your opponents, not just the guy you're locked onto.
Maybe another word to that. I don't know if that's correct, so if I'm wrong, correct me. But if you have, like, let's go into the situation, Dem is playing Shigoki, having an auto summoner throw on Spaniard, and it's charging up his heavy. Bashes would work there, usually.
Yeah. Alright, so about that, there's also the super armor on throws, which is a pretty interesting thing to talk about, because at the same time, while obviously you can't interrupt the throw, they can also eat a lot more damage because of it. Like,
then you want to throw me sideways, and then...
Right there, because he threw him, I could fit in a heavy and a light instead of what would be, you know, one heavy kicks him out of it. So it kind of goes both ways, but that's a bit situational. Bashes are really good for peel against, obviously, hyper armor. And it's also really good because, for example, say I'm a warlord and my teammate is 1v1ing. I can peel for him by headbutting the guy, and that's also a start. A startup for our gank, which is pretty good actually, but that's just tying things together, like ganking, peeling, whatever. There is, like, Dem doesn't have on radar, you don't really have a move from neutral with type armor, so I can't really show. Here, if you go in chain into a chain heavy,
you can storming tap, and then
see that doesn't interrupt, but if you do it again. I did it too late, but it's I can actually stop the hyper armor with the bash. So usually characters with quick bashes, like, you know, Warlord, BP, Gonk, even the new rework characters, Zanhu, maybe even JJ. If you have, like, you're not gonna peel with a Lowbringer shove, because that's way too slow.
It's too slow, yeah.
Now there is another thing to peeling, so. Obviously, your first objective is to stop the enemy from dealing damage to your teammate. Sometimes, your teammate's super high HP, and it's more worth it to let them eat the damage and peel by guard breaking or just peeling later in the recovery so that you can deal more damage. So you trade 20 HP from your teammate for the enemy eating like 60. So it's a bit more profitable like that. So if Dem guard breaks him and zones him, I'll just let him do that, do this, and we can fit in like two heavies and a guard break for his follow-up. It's
I'm not sleeping, then you get two heavies.
Yeah, it's a lot more damage. There's a thing that I want to talk about, which I'll also demonstrate later when we get a fourth, but
I can join.
Not yet. There's a thing in 2v2 if you follow, I don't know, 2v2 tournaments, haven't been some in a while, but with 2v2 scrims, it's usually there's like this cycle that starts happening. Say both teams are Wer or Zanhu. Each one is going to be locked onto a different person. So like right now, Dem is locked onto me. Spaniard is locked onto Dem. And Dem's teammate, which doesn't exist at the moment, would be locked onto Spaniard. And if Dem attacked me, Spaniard would peel, which Dem's partner would peel Spaniard, and I would peel his teammate. And that is kind of a loop you want to avoid getting into, because it's only one side gets in some damage. Maybe nobody even. It's complicated. We'll show that later, though. What else is there, Spaniard?
I guess positioning.
Yes, positioning. So, obviously, like you said, some moves are really good for peeling because of the huge hitbox. So in the 2v2 situation, I can peel them off of Spaniard and also make sure that I hit the other guy, which might be next to me. And obviously, to get really good at peeling and be confident when doing it, because sometimes you can peel, and yeah, you'll save your enemy from 20 damage, but you yourself might eat a lot more. So learning your character's hitboxes, what moves are good for peeling, and range and stuff like that. So like, I know that I have really long range with my zone, so I can be this far out and still peel. Or if he's super far away and I react fast enough, I can do a dodge forward heavy. As for my hitbox, with my zone, I don't really have to worry about it. I mean, Zanhu's zone is insane. It hits everywhere. But there are moves like Warlord zone that is really good for peeling still, but it has much smaller hitbox.
Yeah, Warlord zone goes a long way forward, but doesn't hit too far. I mean, it hits a little bit behind you into the sides, but not as much. Whereas then, you know, a very similar looking move Warlord has, which is this one, has really good horizontal hitbox. I mean, not going to be using that nearly as much, but so that will hit opponents like on all of my sides, whereas the zone will go forward a lot more.
Oh, like here.
It's a decisive hitbox. It can hit you like the animation shows, but its hitbox is much larger.
Yeah.
Sure. You go Warlord as well, then. That's the thing. So we'll show it right here, but if I'm a Warlord, or not me, but Spired is Warlord, he wants to peel for me with zone, and there's a guy directly behind him. Him peeling is not safe, because the guy behind him can just guard break. It kind of works like that. That's why Zanhu's zone, maybe even JJ's zone, even though it doesn't have crazy range, Gensei's zone are really, really good for peeling.
Nobushi's zone as well.
Yeah, Nobushi's zone as well. They're safe. To punish those, you need either your opponent to have a crushing counter or an all guard, or for them to make a read and guard break on the feint if you feint. But then again, you can choose to not feint. So yeah. It gets more complicated after that.
Things like undodgeable light, undodgeable dodge attacks and that kind of thing can go around it.
So let's show that. Dem and Spaniard are one running right now. I go into the point. Dem zones Spaniard. I get my GB. From there on, big damage. If I'm more to this side and he zones, I'm obviously either going to get hit or I'm going to miss. So here, do it again. I'm not going to be able to fit in the guard break. Sometimes you might, like, for example, Warlord zone has no recovery, basically no recovery. Sometimes peeling with a heavy or just any attack in general will get blocked, but that's still peel because they block it, and from there on you can continue. Like, he might zone and I will zone too late, he might block it, from there on I can throw an unblockable, my teammate can confirm it. It's sort of turning whose turn it is to deal damage.
A question to the Zanhu zone.
Yeah.
when we have like a superior block character, let's say Kong, Valk, or Kensei, when they dodge into the attack, do they interrupt the zone?
They don't interrupt it, but you can use that as a counterattack, sort of. So yeah, I don't know how consistent I'll be able to do it, but if them zones here, yeah, that doesn't really hit me. Hit Dragon.
I will try them. You can zone Normie instead, and I will sit here in full block.
Yeah. So you can do that if with a character that has like Conk's heavies that are. What is it, superior heavies? Is that what they're called? Yeah.
Well, they got superior block as well.
With that, you usually have to make a prediction on it because, you know, it's in the move, but... Yeah, no, go ahead.
I mean it's harder. Like, for example, on Valkyrie, it's, like, probably the hardest thing to do. Like, if you get the superior block on external zone and I go for the bleed, would that work or would that would that bleed be interrupted still or bounce off?
That'll normally work. Unless
they work,
can chain into something with... I mean, I think a lot of the... basically, anything that can punish an external non-locked on attack can use to counter peel attempts. And so that does include deflects, but deflects are super hard to pull off on external attacks because you still have the dodging iframe window thing you have to deal with. And also the actual window where you can deflect depends on the opponent's hitbox, which depends on this side you're next to me. So let's say if Dem locked onto me and does the zone and Normie is trying to deflect it, whether he's on that side or on Dem's right or on Dem's left will change the timing that he has to deflect that zone because it hits earlier or later into the attack. Maybe the zone is the easiest option because it to demonstrate on, but you know, affects the window.
In Zanhu's case, it would probably right side hits earlier than left side.
His dead angle is behind him still, like directly behind him. So, but yeah, we're gonna talk about that as well with dead angling, because it does kind of tie into peeling. All right, so, talked about that there, for example, Kensei zone. So if you're ganking a Kensei or whatever, your Kensei tries to peel, Warlord can crushing counter the second part of the zone, or not the second part, but the spinny animation, whatever. BP can flip it. You can superior dodge it into whatever. Like if I hit the timing, which is like really hard to hit, I can do Cures on me then. I can do one of these, but that's obviously really hard to do in Unlocked, like Spaniard said. So,
if you have a forward dodge attack with hyper armor, like Centurion, you can peel through the second hit and do it from distance. So, like, I mean, I can't really do it with Warlord here because it's so slow, but same thing applies. You can do like a long range attack with hyper armor to hit him in the middle of that.
Yeah. In depending on what your positioning is, you're gonna have to use different tools to peel. Like for example, like I showed, I won't be able to guard break them zone recovery if I'm here or on the other side because he will be too far away or hit me out of it. So in a situation like this, I'm gonna have to do a dodge attack to punish him. So here's on him. Oh, that still hit me. That's nuts. Okay, try again.
Good tool.
I'm going to have to do that to avoid the hitbox of the attack and also counter that. That works with really any dodge attack hero.
So dodge attacks are one of the classic peel moves. They allow you to, because they have the safe, like I guess the like an important thing to consider in any of this stuff is safety of the attack you use to peel. Because you want to, as Noi mentioned, you want to cover for your allies, but you also don't want to leave yourself open, and safety makes or breaks a peel tool. So you can have attacks that have very long range and are really good for interrupting on a fast. So for example, I guess one thing about Shaman's four dodge heavy is about the longest range of an attack in the game, but she's in pretty big recovery when she hits it and she has to chain. If she doesn't chain, she's in really bad recovery, and if she does chain, well, she then still has to change to a heavy, and then if faint that into a dodge. So she can be counterpeeled quite easily, which makes that tool, which initially would be good, you know, on the surface level, it appears like it might be a very good tool. In practice, not having the safety means that you can't use it in as many situations as you would want to be able to use it.
Yeah, there's a few things you can go by when trying to figure out what move is good for peeling. For example, there's hitbox of the attack, and so there's hitbox, range, and recovery. Those are the three things. Because right now, Zhanhu has a 360-degree hitbox and really good range. But it does have pretty bad recovery, as long as I don't chain. But the hitbox, is 360. I don't really have to worry about being guard broken because everyone's going to get hit around me. There is Warlord Zone, which we said is pretty small hitbox, but has absolutely no recovery. So it's going to be really hard to punish it. With slower dodge attacks, if you want to try doing what I did earlier with dodge attacking to peel, say for example Kensei or whoever, like Shaolin, they can zone, and if you try to peel, they can even parry the dodge attack. So that's why, for example, Warlord Zone is so good. What's a mediocre peel tool? JJ Zone? With JJ Zone, it's 360, just like Zanhu's, and it can be chained just like Zanhu's with basically the same recovery, but it has very short range. So if I'm like here with JJ, I'm not even going to reach, or like even this close, I'm not going to reach.
Yeah.
So it's not worth it using that as a peel move. And there are attacks like Warlord All Guard Heavy, which is you just don't peel with that.
Yeah.
It's
no range there.
Mediocre hitbox with no range and all the recovery in the universe. I'm thinking most characters have a decent peel tool. Either a decent peel tool or a really good one. So like Zanhu has really good ones. Character like Lawbringer has very mediocre peel.
Lawbringer is the one. Yorm, a terrible peel as well.
Yeah.
His bash is good at interrupting, but it's very short range, so you know, anybody in the sword is heavy as slow as anything.
There's sidelights from you to have basically no range.
Or hitbox either.
Yeah. Peeling with heavies is risky because they're so slow. And if you react slow, you might even, you know, get punished for trying, or obviously, like I said, the dodge forward bash or shove in general is really slow and not worth using as a peel tool.
Ooh, there's another factor that runs into peeling with, especially with lights, is something that... So we know you have enhanced lights, which are, you can chain a light on block. So, you know, I can carry on chaining my lights on blocks. And normally, most lights, if you block like, so Zhanhu's lights are blocks, not like dodge attacks, they're enhanced as well now. But yeah. Normally, throw the light attack, he's going to be put in superior block stun. But there's also, as well as having enhanced or regular lights on the opponents you're locked onto, there's also whether or not they are going to be blocked by your ally. So if we can switch characters, and I will go Black Prior, and then you go, I don't know, someone with a full block. So
you don't even need a full block.
Stupid. You go Black Prior, and so you're recording.
Yeah.
So this is what we call externally enhanced attacks, or externally, normal, non-enhanced. You can go whichever you want. I will go a character who's got externally enhanced. Like, I'll go Kensei, because Kensei's got very big hitboxes, but her lights are externally enhanced. So basically this means, are you going to have your light interrupted by being blocked by an opponent who you're not locked onto? So this, not just an opponent, an opponent or an ally that you're not locked onto. And some characters, it's really arbitrary, to be honest. There doesn't give you any rhyme or reason to which characters have it and which ones don't. But some characters will have their lights that interrupted on block by external opponents or allies, and some will be able to just carry on attacking through it. So Kensei and BP are two examples of characters with really good hitboxes on their sidelights. But if Normie, you see, he's now bouncing off and he's...
Yeah, do other side so you can see better.
So when you say that, like, is it only externals and allies, or is it your, like, direct or locked on opponent as well?
Well, I mean, his lights are normal, so they will be bounced. They will bounce off. Not
yeah.
Okay.
Well. But BP can't really use his side lights as peel in the same way because they will be bounce off. Whereas if you look at Kensei, yeah, I guess you're going to.
See, his don't bounce off of my guard.
No, not. So, damn if you don't block these because it'll look a bit monkey. So.
Lock onto him then.
You can see that my side light there is hitting it into Normie's block, but it's still chaining. I can still carry on chaining. And this also applies to superior blocks as well. So if your attacks are externally enhanced, you can chain even if you get superior blocked. So,
it works. I mean, they don't bounce off of mine because my all guard is bad, but basically it's the same thing. It's literally the same thing. Just count... All guarding externally is just like blocking.
Yeah. So if I'm playing Kensei, I'm using my dodge attacks, which I'm like, I'm target switch to a different person, and there's a warlord or a conqueror that I'm attacking is going to hit externally. Even if they full block my dodge attack, I can still chain into my hyper armored heavy and trade with whatever they threw. So, I mean, we can swap over if you want to show that. Normie would be the one, on the opponent, like the outnumbered character.
It's not really. I mean, like, wait, with it just is different with every all guard, by the way, as well. Because BP's all guard doesn't act the same way. BP's all guard will always be staggered, so it doesn't bounce off. So here, if them all guards an attack from a Spaniard, so attack into it. See, it'll bounce off regardless of what it is, light, heavy, whatever. With me, if them attacks into me, light, heavy, whatever, I'm always going to be staggered. Even with the lights that are not enhanced. So it doesn't really work the same way. I'd have to flip the counter.
And it does mean that, like, so we talk about how that means some superior blocks aren't usable. Let's swap over so we can demonstrate it all, because it is a little bit weird to show off, to just talk about it. If you go Kensei, Normie, and then I'll go Konk. And then Dem can go, whoever he wants. Oh, actually, Dem, you go Warlord as well, because then go Warlord again, because then you can demonstrate the two different. It also comes into how quickly your punish can actually, your full block, your superior block punish can actually hit the character that we are.
Are you supposed to be on that team?
Yeah, because you're going to go Kensei. Okay. I'll go Konk, and then we'll go Warlord. So there is no, like I said, there's no real rhyme or reason for this. You just have to know which characters have externally enhanced attacks and which don't. And you can find that information in the info hub. I've done a bunch of testing on this a long time ago. So some characters with really good hitboxes have non-externally enhanced lights, which can really fuck them over, like BP, for example. And JJ is the worst example of it.
JJ and the BP are like the biggest
because their hitboxes are massive, but they are external. So if I full block in front of you, Normie, well, first off, you can attack into my full block, and then you'll see that I can he gets interrupted. But now if you lock on to Dem and then do the same thing, you can carry on chaining.
You're gonna go to Stem.
He
can still do his counter. So Spider can still do his heavy, so here, right here. And I'll get hit with it. But if I had a chain move that would have hyper armor, so say if I was
Raider. Do your dodge heavy instead.
Oh yeah, that's true. There you go. So you can exploit you can make a read on your enemy trying to punish it and use your kit accordingly to punish that. So if we show that again.
Yeah.
Oh well, see, even that works. Yeah, it's a bad trade, but it interrupts. Yeah. It's
But what, of course, doesn't work is if we do the other round and that say dodge attack me and Dem crushing counters your dodge attack. Yeah, with his light.
Like that.
Yeah, so Dem normally is not going to be able to chain fast enough to get hyper armor.
Yeah, no, not with this character.
Yeah.
It depends on the crushing counter. For example, I think is BP's slower? I think it's
no. Any 500 MS crushing counters now will work. I mean, like things like Conk's superior block heavy will you be able to chain off that? But crushing counter lights are gonna interrupt you pretty much whatever. Like you can't.
Zerk can deal with this. His chain into hyper armor is fast enough. Really? Is that worth demonstrating?
Yeah, I mean, you can if you want to. I didn't think it was fast enough because
it is. It is actually a thing because a lot of people are trying to CC your dodge light.
Yeah.
I think it works because the CC comes out later than it would if you were locked onto the person CCing. Because of how hitboxes hit later and stuff. And because of that, you get enough time to chain into your unblockable. So, for example, this is a pretty big thing while anti-ganking with Zerk, which is I can do that. So I can dodge light, get CC'd on purpose to then go into a top unblockable, and I'll take like 15 or however much it is and deal 31.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I can do that, and he'll hit me with 15, and if he changes heavy, making a read that I'm going to do that, I eat, like, way more. It's sort of a interesting trading game. So let's see if I can do that here. Here, all guard? Or all guard into light. Oh, that was really delayed light. That or CCing.
And now crouching counter the light, said. Oh, yeah. I did not know that was fast enough. Damn.
So if Dem does CCs into heavy, it should hit me. Oh, nice. Try again. See? It's.
Or if you do it on me and I do the.
Isn't the hyper armor on Zerk like 300 milliseconds?
Too badass.
How much is it, Spaniard? The hyper armor on Zerk? On Zerk.
I mean, I thought it was within 100 MS, but apparently it's just instant and like it just lasts the entire time.
100? No, quick.
I think it's not. I think it's just, just constant.
Yeah, I'm gonna look that up.
I mean, well, measuring hyper armor is quite hard.
Yeah.
To do.
Because the effect is pretty weird.
Yeah, the glow is hard. You have to time it by interrupting people, and it's just a pain in the butt to do. But
apparently it's 100. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. 100. Well, that's what it says in the info hub, but like that might not.
No, be. It is 100. It's just that it's fast enough. 100 is fast enough.
Well, with chain links, you have like always a minimum of normally like 200 in between. But so that's why I thought that even with a chain link, normally crushing counters will interrupt instantaneous hyper armor because you have 200 MS at least in between the attacks where you'd lose the hyper armor, but apparently that's not the case with Zerk. So it might be that he just has it on his in between attacks as well. I don't know actually.
Oh that thing with externally blocking, crushing, countering, all guarding your opponent's attacks is still peel because they're trying to hit your enemy that they're locked onto and you can prevent that. You can get really creative with peel. If you really want, you can even peel with like a range feat, like bow or something.
Yeah.
It's really whatever. It used to be a thing back when Pujo was not banned in comp, where they just wait for the enemy to throw something, peel with a Pujo, and from there on you can do the gank, which was insane damage.
Well, let's switch over and you go Warlord, Norby, because I want to show basing your opponent's peel to ensure that you get a punish. You'll see this an awful lot with Warlord in 2v2s. So you're always thinking about what you can peel, but also what the opponents can peel against you. So we'll both go on, and I'll go, fuck it, it doesn't really matter. I'll go Jan Hu because Again, it doesn't matter which one either of us go down, but what Normie's going to do is he's going to use his headbutt to bash Dem and try and get, you know, he's going to try and land his damage. But if he goes for a normal headbutt poke light, I can punish him with my zone. It's got long range, and you know, as we discussed, it's a really good peel tool. But what Normie can do is wait for that peel attempt that he knows is coming, and then crush and counter that to, like, counter the peel attempt and still get damage with his guaranteed attack.
This is really good, and it definitely takes a bunch of practice to not to get down, but to use properly, because you can also, I mean, I'll demonstrate here in a second. Yeah. So if I just do a headbutt into light, I'll get peeled. Yeah, I do my damage, but I also damage myself. So it's just a trade. And from there on, he can actually go into an unblockable and, you know, gank me. It's whatever. It's their turn to attack. What I can do is this, which is it's the same input, just wait for you inputting your light a bit later, which is still confirmed. Is it confirmed? I don't know. Them trying to parry.
It's confirmed. I don't think he can parry it.
What if he does?
If I delay it, then yeah. It puts you in hits. Headbutt puts you in hit stun for 800 milliseconds, so you'd have to be really slow on the on that. To,
yeah, with BP.
If I was really BP. Slow on the peel, then maybe it would, yeah.
Yeah, BP can be parried from what I know, because his is not slower, but like just the way the bash works is...
Yeah, you have to wait longer before you can input your regular light opener when not going to a chain opener and chain light.
Oh, so you can do this. This is why, again, like Spanier said, this is why World is so good in 2v2s. Even when doing a move that on paper has a lot of recovery, like I can be BGB'd or peeled for ages after I land my headbutt, something like this does... like, that still works, but if he tries to attack into me, here's on me again.
Oh, yeah.
I can keep going from there. Another scenario is, I can do my, oh wait, you should probably kill me, because I'm alone. Kill me. You can even target switch the light that's supposed to crush and counter to hit the guy that is trying to peel. Which is good because usually in a situation where I'm being ganked, the guy with more HP is gonna be 1v1ing me, and the other guy is only going to try to peel where he needs to. So here, if I get you to like 1 HP, like this.
But now, I mean,
this is the case. There's going to be a situation where the low HP guy is gonna get targeted by him aggressively.
Yeah, when that happens, that's where you can see the things that we said like in action, because I'm going to be hungry to get the kill on that guy, and it's free peel for them. So I can do whatever I want, and then would be there to peel and wouldn't be at risk because he's such high HP.
The only way that Normie can kill me here without putting himself at risk is using a light attack. And obviously light attacks are reactable, so I can, maybe not to me, but I could block them. And if he wasn't using Warlord, having a light attack blocked is a guaranteed guard break from your other opponent.
Yeah, so if his light bounced off instead of doing this, it would get broken. So let me try that thing. So try peeling with zone. See right there? I could target switch that as well. So let me kill you. You can get creative... with the, all right. I get it.
Damn, just...
Is this what we're doing? You want to 1v1? Is this what we're doing?
Right, no, onesie with friends.
Onesie with friends, dude. But BP can do this. Any character with any sort of baiting out peel for...
Yeah, Jan, you can do it with his dodge bash. You can bait into a deflect. Into a deflect, so I can dodge bash and then recovery cancel it to deflect the peel attempt. Some characters do it with, you see Nabushi doing it with her kick. She kicks and then she will hidden stance to bait a peel attempt and then punish what the opponent has. And because the opponent has been like that, you know, if there's a 2v1 scenario and Greg is playing Nabushi and he kicks me, and Dem tries to peel, well, I'm going to be in a long recovery from just being kicked. So when Nabushi then goes into hidden stance to punish the peel attempt, I can't do anything to counter that peel because I'm just in the recovery from being bashed. So, yeah. And this is why like recovery cancels and anything you can do that even stuff that's not in recovery. So you can do Lawbringer's bash isn't going to be landing anytime, but when he was meta, he would bash and then people will come in and try and punish it with like a dodge light, and he just parries that and you know just waits for the peel attempt and parries it instead of going for the confirmed punish. So a lot of the time when you get, you know, when you, and the thing is, the thing that you really have to think about is the biggest switch to switch on when you're going into team fights and thinking about peel is stopping thinking about like you're guaranteed punishes all the time. You know, I got a guard break, I'm gonna go for a side heavy because that is my punish. Well, that's often gonna result in you eating more damage doing your guaranteed punish or not getting your punish off in a team fight scenario against good opponents. So you have to start thinking about not what is the punish you can do, but what is your safe punish. So, you know, maybe if I get a guard break, instead I can zone, because that's going to hit around everyone around me and it's going to stop me being peeled.
Yeah, sure. I'll demonstrate it. So here, get closer to them, Spaniard. So like, if I was to do guard break and do my top heavy, right here, I can eat a lot of damage, especially with hyper armor. Like if he did that, what he did there, and chained into another heavy, unless I decided to trade with him, I'd eat a lot of damage. So instead, I just do this. Or, hey, you can even do this. Anything, yeah. Really.
Yeah, or yeah, you can crush and counter my light. Same.
I mean, you're going to need to do that pretty quick.
Yeah.
I mean,
maybe it was a zone too slow. Yeah.
Yeah, you need to be really quick. But you'll see that a lot in scrims with people. Because another thing is trying to peel headbutt. So as you saw earlier, a Spaniard was dealing damage to me off the headbutt, but I was still getting my damage in, so it was just a trade. In really high-level scrims, you're going to be having people react really quick to the headbutt and hit me before I even get to do my light after the headbutt.
My reactions are not fastest.
So there's a lot that goes into it. Like I said, it's hitboxes, even reactions, just positioning, it's whatever.
Yeah, I think the key is thinking is really to peel is you have to think about the team fight as a team fight and not just as disconnected 1v1s. And this is why characters who are really good in 1v1s, like Warden, just aren't very good in team fights necessarily, because they can be interrupted and peeled. All their pressure relies on things that can be peeled. Other things that are good for this is why direct damage bashes are really good. So Aramusha's bash and Goki's headbutt,
okay.
Because they do direct damage. You know, even if you're getting peeled off landing it, you've got the damage in already. So you're not gonna miss out on at least even if you end up trading, it's the worst case scenario to trade rather than an interrupt where you get nothing. Yes, there's one other thing I want to talk about with peel, which is peel on a... So with all the stuff we talked about here is really team fights. And this is all relevant to, brawls and 2v2 tournaments, as well as team fights on points. But peel can also mean... can also be used in a macro sense, in the context of Dominion. So Let's say Dem has been 1v1ing Normie and he's on low on health, and he's in, let's say they're fighting in mid, and he really needs to go and heal. I can come in and now I'm starting to put pressure on Normie, and essentially I'm peeling for Dem to go get his heal out, and Dem is now able to run away and go to the zone and heal himself and not feed renown from dying and not die. And so people also use peel in the context of protecting. It's just a generic term for meaning protecting your opponents, covering for your opponents, and that can also mean apply on a team, like a whole match thing, as well as just team fights. So yeah, rotations can also play into peel as well. Would you agree with that, Normie, or am I?
Yes. So yeah, there is a bunch of different scenarios. Like we showed the direct fight peel, and Spaniard showed the normal peeling somebody off to, you know, run away in a situation where they're 1v1ing. They're not 1v1ing because they're the same thing. I'm 1v1ing, and like you said, he comes in to rotate. It's not even necessarily that they're ganking me. It just comes in, and obviously low guy runs away, other guy peels, go to heal. It's wasting my time, and also probably going to make me die because I technically have to fight two people at the same time. So yeah, it's really important. Peeling is really, really important.
Yeah, and it's one of these things when you find like opponents who tunnel vision a low health, like you run to one opponent, they're tunnel visioning your low health ally. Well, they're giving you free peel. Like their instinct is to chase the guy who's on low health, but you have to kind of resist doing that because against opponents who know what they're doing, you're just gonna get killed for it. You know, you'll eat more damage trying to get that last bar of health off the guy who's, you know, low in health than you will overall.
Yeah. So
in general, when you're being ganked, the priority for you is to stall, not usually to get a kill.
Yeah.
Yes.
But you get a kill. Get a kill if you can. Usually it's a good idea, but mostly just stall.
Yeah, but it applies in team fights as well. If we're in a 3v3 and there's one person who's really low health,
try to kill.
You know, they're gonna try and go for that. One person might try and go for that kill, and you know, it's definitely a benefit to a team to turn a 3v3 into a 2v3. But they've got to be really careful to, you know, make sure that doing that doesn't actually get them peeled and take more damage.
Again, in team fights, yeah, it's a good idea to get rid of your opponent. It heavily goes in your favor. But one being obviously 1v2, 3, 4, then yeah, stalling is a good idea.
You see this, but no, you see this in, I meant in 3v3s, like you see this in 2v2 tournaments and stuff. Like they'll have an opponent who is low health and they don't focus the one guy who's low health. You try and get, so let's say we're in a 2v2. Dem is on low health, and people will leave Dem alive for longer because they know that A, he can't really do much without if he puts himself in any kind of recovery, he's dead. So he's already, by being on low health, you're already out of the fight to a certain extent just because you have no more health to, you know, you can't trade with your health bar anymore. So he's already, there's not much Dem can do. And they know that if they go after Dem, well, I'm on full health and I'm going to try and peel for Dem. So they're opening themselves up if they go after him. So they instead focus on me. And you'll see this a lot with opponents who got out of stamina. So your first instinct on an out of stamina opponent is, well, the opponent is out of stamina. We can pressure them because the reward, potential reward for punishing them when they're out of stamina is much higher. But what's going to happen, actually, if you watch 2v2 tournaments, one person goes out of stamina, the other two people will attack their opponent who's still got stamina. And the reason is that whilst the out-of-stamina opponent is more vulnerable in themselves, actually, the opponent who has still got stamina is the more vulnerable opponent because they can't be peeled for anymore because their ally is out of stamina. So their ally who's got stamina is more vulnerable than the one who's out of stamina, because they haven't got a friend to keep them safe. And that's almost counterintuitive, because you think, well, the out of stamina guy is more vulnerable, but actually it's the other way around. Because
Well, I mean, when the guy is out of stamina, he's gonna usually be more defensive.
Yeah, but it's...
No, but it's like, out of stamina guy cannot save his teammate. Yeah.
Like,
if you try like to guard break, stuff like that, the other guy who does have stamina can easily peel on you.
Exactly,
because you can't really utilize the full punishes.
Well, yeah, that's another reason as well. Like, you'll see this a lot as well. Mistake people make in team fights is throwing opponents. We talked a little about throw super armor, but what also throws have put damage reduction on the person you're throwing as well. So you've got to be really careful not to throw in. I mean, like sometimes wall splats, your bigger punishes from a wall splat than from a guard break. They used to try and go for war splats in team fights, but actually they end up just eating a bunch of damage. They're never going to get their war splat off because, well, even if they do war splat me, Dem's going to come peel for me anyway. And if they do war splat me, then their teammates can't add extra damage to me because I'm going to be in damage reduction. So
I can show that. We can show that here. So here, if I get GB'd by one of them, they can get in two heavies. So
Dem me GB.
That's two heavies. Yeah, one of them is damage reduced, but it's like, what, 20%?
Yeah.
On if I get wasplatted, one of them gets full punish, and the other guy gets six damage and full venge.
And full venge. So definitely don't want to do that. And I think that's a mistake a lot of people make. You see a lot of people throwing in team fights, and when you're throwing the match.
Yes.
I mean, of course, the scenario is if you get a free kill on the opponent because you throw them into a ledge or into an environmental hazard, then it can be worth going for, but it's still very risky because you're going to eat damage whilst doing it.
Another question to that 3v3 scenario. Would you say it's more beneficial towards one team to like reduce the overall HP pool of the other team instead of going for like confirmed kills?
All right, so about that.
Not confirmed kills, just kills. Sorry.
Yeah, about this. So visualize that 3v3 team fight in Citadel Gate mid, for example. Most of the time, there's never going to be a 3v3 like full-on fight where everybody's just throwing attacks left and right. What's usually going to happen is it's either going to slowly split up into a 2v2 and a 1v1. Or if one of the teams fucks up, it's going to be a 3v2 for like even like 4 seconds, 5 seconds. That's enough to deal a lot of damage just because they're outnumbered. And the other guy is, went to clear minions or something. In an actual team fight where everybody is there, the 3v3, nothing's really gonna happen. If you watch any scrims, you're gonna see that at the beginning, both teams are literally just staring at each other and sometimes doing an external zone that's super far out of range to clear a few minions. Because obviously, if it's a 3v3, I wanna attack a guy, but the other two guys on his team can peel me, and having to count on my teammates to peel two people at the same time, it's a lot riskier. So, yeah, that's it. If there's an actual 3v3, you're usually just going to stare at each other until it breaks up into a 2v2 and a 1v1.
Yeah.
That's why...
A while ago, there were some 3v3 tournaments that people were doing, and they just... Basically, the meta of this 3v3 tournaments, it was like the idea of making brawls, but 3v3, and it just turned into a 2v2 and two shinobis, which would sit back and throw range attacks, because that was the only way that you could be aggressive, is have somebody like be, you know, in a 2v2 and then have like, you know, long range shit to deal with.
Now, to actually talk about what you were saying with getting people lower HP or killing. It depends on the situation. For example, say it's like I said, 3v3 in mid, and both points are capped by each team. So each team has their home point capped with one person boosting, and a 3v3 in mid. That's a scenario we're talking about. So in mid, say one of the people on Team Orange fucks up, eats half their health bar and damage. What they're going to want to do is rotate out. While that happens, while the rotation happens, that fight turns from a 3v3 into a 3v2. Yeah, like I said, it might be like 2 seconds, 3 seconds. Well, while the rotation happens, it's enough to get in a whole bash gank. So that's what, like 70 damage. If the team fight happens and you get people to, like, say the entire enemy team is half HP, then what they're going to want to do is... they're going to want their fourth to come in and have either a 4v3, where, yeah, they might have low health, but they have numbers advantage, or they're going to have their guy come in, and one of the guys that's low will go heal, and the other people will have to turtle up really hard and just try to not throw anything out and not eat anything. It's so they wait for their teammate to heal and come back, and then it's a better fight to take. And that's it ties back into stalling, and you're just stalling the fight until you get your HP back, whatever.
And in those kills, it is a good idea to kill, you know, if you can, get a kill. Because if you don't get the kill, well, they're probably going to rotate. You get an advantage, numbers advantage momentarily, but they're still going to be able to rotate out, and they're going to be able to heal and come back in again.
Yeah. So at the beginning of a fight, same scenario. Beginning of a match, and once it's in the game mid, the first call out you're going to hear is, this guy ate a bunch of damage. That guy is now not out of the fight, but has to keep himself from trying to throw too much shit out or trying to peel too much, because he can die. And if he chooses to go back to his point, they're going to be outnumbered. It's usually most of the time, it's more beneficial to actually leave a guy on 1 HP, just running around the map. I wouldn't say meta, but thing that happens a lot in comp now in recent scrims is each team, or like one team, caps the two side points, so A and C. And they have two people on each point, and the guys are stuck with mid. In mid, they can't heal. That's the main point. If they try to push a point, two people try to push a point, first of all, they can lose, do poorly in the 2v2 and have nowhere to heal. Or, and at the same time, while they're 2v2ing, the other two people have nothing to do other than clear maintenance, which is not enough point gen to be more than two boosted points. So what they're going to have to do is a four-man push a point, which in that scenario, the two people are holding a point down will have to not do anything, peel for each other, be very careful, and wait till the other two rotate in to make it a 4v4.
Can I ask something?
I'll let Noe finish this little bit, and then you can ask.
All right.
Yeah, so that's like we talked before with ganks and stuff. Stalling is probably the most important thing, and to stall, obviously not while you're being ganked, but to stall, you have to be good at peeling. Use it effectively, make sure you're safe from it, because obviously you might peel and nobody's there to peel you. So yeah, whatever you wanted to say, go ahead.
Okay, so as you said, in terms of letting the guy live instead of killing him outright.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, in a scenario, let's say in a point, this also happens often in breach, but also in the control points. So let's say you manage to go for a 2v2 in a point.
Yeah.
And you peel, manage to peel a guy until he has like very low HP. Is it more beneficial to leave him like that and have him be less effective at trying to attack? And outright just killing him, and the other guy who is very good at stalling goes into a situation where the guy who died just respawns and comes back.
Depends on what the current status of the map is. So if that happens and they have a point, it's more beneficial to kill the guy, because it's better to have him out of the game for however long. What is the being dead plus respawn timer plus having to come all the way back, then having him just switch out and go to heal. But in that scenario that I told you earlier, with both points being capped, it's much better to leave a guy with 1 HP. He's got nowhere to heal, and all he can do is try to jump off somewhere or die to minions, so to prevent a renown gain on the enemy team.
If you play really badly, he can get out there and then go and cap your point. An opponent on 1 HP is still usable. They can still do stuff, but they just have much less freedom in what the things they can do. Now, if you let your 1 HP opponent run around the map, well, they can go and back cap and unbreak. Whatever.
But if your team has good control over the map and is aware, the guy is quite literally useless, because he can't join a fight. He's going to die instantly. If he goes to back up and you are aware, that's a free kill on a point for insane renown. Yep. And if he goes to clear your mid, He's going to clear a bit of mid and 90 minions, which is the best thing that he can do. Clear minions until he dies and respawns.
Unless so, he's Legion and goes to a point on one health and just wins a full health.
Legion things.
Gang. Yeah, but like, basically, even Legion messes those things up more often than he gets them right.
He messes up more than everyone else.
Yeah, well, I mean, he tries to do his insane 1v1s on no health, and sometimes he does pull them off, and then they can be game-winning, but most of the time, he's against good opponents, and that won't happen. And realistically, your you shouldn't overvalue your abilities. You know, if you're going into a fight on one bar of health, you're going to lose that fight 99% of the time, maybe, you know, meaning not that much, but almost always you will lose that fight. Even if you vastly outmatch an opponent, like, you know, you can watch Barak's duel videos in his, you know, when he's playing in ranked and he runs into a gold ranked person, he's going to stomp this person 3-0, but he's going to eat like one or two attacks. He's not going to get perfect every round. And that's, if that's enough to kill you, I mean, you've lost that fight. So, yeah.
That's really what determines the course of a fight. Is it kind of just, if you think about it, just all revolves around peel. Because I remember, I'm gonna say this from back when I first joined comp and played around, we were all really, really good players and were on par with the best team. It's just that we didn't have the experience in peeling and stalling a point if needed to have people come in. We just die too fast, and even though in a team fight, the 3v3, we might win because we're better at team fighting, in a 3v2 we'd lose because we can't peel well enough. So that's the thing. If fight goes bad, turtle up, peel for your teammate, don't get greedy. If you're in a normal team fight, 3v3, and one of your teammates eats a lot of damage, you're going to want to get around them and make sure you keep them in the back of the fight, or have them rotate out, peel for him.
Yeah.
So, without peel, every fight is lost.
Yes, peel is super, super important. The most important thing you can learn to be successful in front of a high-ish or even a medium level, you know? In any kind of coordination, this is a benefit. And you can peel, of course, even without coordination. Talking of which, I think we should... We've been talking for a long time now. I think we have a bit of time for the dojo. I think what we should do is have some people do a 2v2 scrim, some brawl scrims, and then Normie can spectate, and we can talk a bit about the peel at... opportunities as they go by. Does that sound good to you, Normie?
Oh yeah, that's fine. All right.
Any volunteers who wants to?
Thank you.
Sure.
All right. So
can I ask a quick question?
Yeah, of course. Questions first.
No worries. It was relation to what you said earlier about the whole 2v2. If you have two people holding each side points and not B, and you said if they send four over to one of them. You said that you would most likely just make it a 4v4. Would it still be beneficial for the other two that aren't fighting to just go cap B and cap minion lane? Because then you'd still be up 2 points, right? Or is there a reason not to do that?
If that's where comms come in, you talk to your team, they're like, all right, we are 2v3 right now, or even 2v4 right now. And you're asking, how long can you stall? And they're going to be like, yeah, I have Jug. Yeah, I have this feat. Yeah, we can do this. They're like Warlord and Kensei. They're really good twos comp. They can stall out the fight really well. In that case, yeah, you go and cap the point, the other point, and then even if your teammates die, they're going to try to die off points to not feed, and you have 2 points, which is a lot better. In a situation where your teammates are going to be like, oh, I use Jug already, I don't have it, or they're really unsafe characters like Warmonger, for example, which is really, really almost useless without peel from teammates. They're gonna be like, okay, we're gonna come and help, or maybe they're gonna send one to make it a 3v4, which is much easier to stall out while the other guy caps the point. So it depends on the score, what the current score is, and who has control of what on the map.
Okay, thank you.
As for the 2v2 thing, I was actually thinking I might want to play on one of the teams so I can explain my thought process through it.
All right.
Yeah. Who wants to play in that case? I'm
interested.
I'm interested. I'm not up for playing. I will watch.
All right. So we have two. We need one more. So
hello.
All right. There you go. There you go. Very good.
Do we just add you then, Normie?
Yeah. Add me. It's Greg with 2 underscores. So here, I'll even put it in. Where do I put it?
Dojo General.
Yeah, Dojo General. It's Greg.
So that should be it. Try to make it a little bit balanced, so we make sure it's not just a. So whoever is looking to nominate somebody. I have memes. You've got quite a lot of experience. And Basilisk, you're quite a well. Who here feels confident that they can help their team not be just stomped by Normie? And
yeah, sure.
I'm confident.
All right. Okay. Well, we'll split you. You two guys can go and you can be on a team together, and then we'll have the third person. With Normie be maybe like a...
What we can do is... So I'm not going to record it. And obviously, we're going to be in separate VCs. Meanwhile, Spaniard can spectate if he wants to and do a bit of live talking over it. And after that, I'm going to be back with the recording and we'll talk that through.
That's cool. I think Stag has set it up, so it's all just streaming from him watching on Discord, isn't it? So.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
We
can stay in here actually because I'm still streaming. We can just stay in here and Stag's still here and you guys can move somewhere else.
Yeah, makes sense.
All right, I'm gonna need you guys to tell me what your names are so I know who to accept.
Potato, I already sent you.
Tomo, I already sent you as
potato,
well.
Potato, Mango, and who?
Tomo. I sent the invite. I mean, friend request.
Yeah, hold on, I'm looking through them.
Are you guys still taking questions at all?
Yeah, sure.
Go ahead.
Who are some good team fighters? Like, I'm 2v2s and all that.
Okay, I can go with some of the... In the Knights faction, Black Prior is probably one of the best 2v2ers. Griffin is good as well. He's got his dodge attacks, which are quite good. He's got 4 dodge light, which is good for interrupting as well, so that's quite a good peel tool, but he has quite big recoveries on his dodge attacks as well, so he can be quite vulnerable. Same with his kick. In the Vikings, Warlord is sort of unparalleled. The best 2v2 comp, at least for a long time, has been Warlord and Kensei. Warlord has, as we've talked, he has so many tools that make him great for team fights and 2v2s. He's got his enhanced lights, so he can throw lights without worrying about being guard broken. He's got headbutt, which is good pressure, which he can be used safely because he can crush and counter lights. He's got zone, which is like one of the best peel tools in the game. It's got insane reach and it's undodgeable, so that also helps. Zerka is pretty good in 2v2 still. He's got, you know, he suffers from having a lack of health, which doesn't help him with trading, but he can dodge cancel out of things. He can use his undodgeable lights. He can target swap those. He's quite hard to peel against because he has so much hyper armor and he can trade with most things apart from bashes, and bashes tend to have shorter range as well. So if he does like an external dodge light to be on the other side of the fight from an opponent with a bash, then he can still chain quite safely and mix up. Then some other really good 2v2ers, we have Kensei. He's got his dodge heavies that got huge range and go everywhere and go, he can attack people very easily. He's got hyper armor to chain into them to make them safer. He's got his zone, which is really, really good peel tool because it hits everywhere. And if you put in hit stun from it, then or block stun, he's safe. 4 dodge lights, good as well.
Give me a stick. That's
better. 3-hit chains are actually underrated in terms of making a character safer because it means you can throw out 2 attacks and you can still chain into a finisher, and then you won't put yourself in a recovery. Whereas if you have a 2-hit chain, Unless you've got really low recoveries on misses, you can actually paint yourself quite vulnerable just by throwing out a finisher. So that is a something that's useful. Shigoki then is another excellent 2v2 character to, you know, probably meta really.
I heard he's strong in 4v4, isn't he?
Yeah, he's strong in every mode now. He's got insane hitboxes on his hyper-armored heavies, which are obviously hyper-armored, so they're super hard to peel, hard to interrupt. And they do huge damage. He's got his headbutt, which is good pressure externally, and is really safe because you can chain to hyper-armored heavies. So
that's even if it misses, you cannot guard break it.
You can't guard break it, yeah. That's, I mean, guard breaks, when you're in 2v2s, guard breaks are not always the punish of choice, because when you guard break somebody, and actually this is probably something we should have covered as well, a lot of mix-ups work with attack or guard break. You know, like say, let's say Aramush is four dodge heavy into, or his heavies into pommel strike, into his ring the bell, they are the bash, or you feint it and guard breaks to catch your dodge. Well, the thing is, mix-ups which work with something and feint to guard break are much less usable in 2v2 situations or in team fights in general, because putting yourself into a guard break makes you very vulnerable, because you can't dodge out of a guard break, you can't parry out of a guard break, you can throw an attack, but you're going to get peeled if it's a slower attack. Some characters, if they're in a guard break, if they get a guard break on their opponent, it's actually really, really bad for them, and they're more likely to take damage from landing a guard break than they are from, you know, than just having it countered. So that's something you've got to think about as well. What I was going about.
So it's like demon balling and like a 4v4 team fight.
Yeah, demon ball is one of it's an interesting one, because it's basically the worst possible move you can use when you're outnumbered, because you put yourself not only in guard break recovery, which is already, you know, dangerous to be in, you put yourself in super armor so that they can land two heavies on you. If there's three people and you guard break one of them and you demon ball that guy, well, the two others, you're just dead. The two others are going to throw two heavies each, and no one, like, even Goki's not surviving four heavies, you know, two opens and two finishes. So, you know, you have to use a zone in that case to punish a guard break. But there's some characters, if you get a guard break on you know, an opponent, you're actually really bad for you. Like Shinobi, I mean, if he gets a regular guard break, I mean, actually, in many characters, like, let's go, Gladiator, if he gets a guard break, what's he going to do? He's going to throw a heavy, but he's going to get peeled for it, and it's not got great hitboxes, so he's not going to be able to hit the people on side of you. If you're playing a character like Zhanhu, who's got good hitboxes, you can throw a side heavy hitbox and a side heavy to punish your guard break, and you can still hit the person who's next to you. So that's a way you can keep yourself a bit safer. So going down the list of good team fighters, Nabushi is an excellent team fighter as well, and she's really good in 2v2s. She's got her zone, she's got undodgeables from hidden stance, she's got good peel from her forward dodge lights and her zone as well. Kick is safe because you can recovery cancel the land of kick into hidden stance and then dodge out of that. She's got dodge cancels out the wazoo. She's very, very good. I mean, Aramusha is not as bad as he used to be. He used to be one of the worst 2v2 characters in the game, but now he's got dodge attacks at work. He's got his recovery cancels into Blade Blockade, which are really flexible for punishing any kind. So it's really hard to peel against Aramusha if you haven't got a bash, because he can go into Blade Blockade, you know, on reaction to anything.
Right. Okay, so you two guys are going to need to be moved or go down to a different VC where it's just the two of you. I think I put Spectator on. I should be on. Here, let me check, actually. I don't want to troll a bit. Spectator's on, yeah, right. So if you want to go to a different VC and spectate Spaniard, you can.
I'm just worried that will break this stream if you...
I'm gonna stay here and stream so that I don't have to, like...
Okay, all right. Let me just make another voice channel in that case.
So everybody can stay here if they want muted, but other than that, all right. So move the two on the other team, and you can, as for characters, pick whatever you want. We've already talked good two scums. I'm going to record it, and Spider does this thing live, and after that, we're going to review it from my recording.
Join me in a spectating channel if you want to watch my Twitch show.
All right. Yeah.
But either we're gonna probably gonna go into 1v1 channel down there somewhere.
Yeah, just go wherever. What character do I go here? Probably goes on there. Alright, let me start the recording. What I'm going to need for you as my teammate is to, if you can, tell me when you need to pay attention to their bench. That's all, really. Make sure...
Stay unmuted?
No, you can stay unmuted. Yeah, you're fine. I'm going to need you to talk. Okay. Just, I'm going to tell you when somebody's high bench. I'm going to say, chill on this guy or don't touch this guy. When I say that, try your best to... not touch at all. Like, I mean, nothing.
Okay.
It's basically it. There's another thing which we said, which was if a guy's out of stamina, we're going to try to kill the other guy with stamina.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, let's see. All right, that was tough. Let me check if I'm still recording. Should be fine, yeah. All right, be careful on eating damage. Stay behind me if you can. Very good. Nice job staying alive. I need to hang back a bit. Nice PR. Very nice, actually. Wow.
How long are we going to do this?
We can do first to 10.
Okay.
Cool. Okay. All right, I guess they're going. I ate a bunch of damage and I ate a bit more. I think I'm dead here. Yeah, my bad there. Unlucky.
Round five.
Oh, I'm getting a bunch of damage. They are giving me revenge though. I'm out of the fight for a bit. I fucked up. Oh, man. Thanks, he says. Sheesh.
No, no, no. I have 74 ping. I saw it earlier. So
that's not bad. It's still under 100 total, so you're fine. All right, that went fast. Round seven. Oh. Nice PM. You guys dead? Or should be. There we go. I'm out of stamina.
Come on.
Yeah, that's right. Keep it like this, they won't get more rounds. Good feel. Bad for me.
Round
Cool. Okay, we need to slow down a bit. We're taking too much damage. You're gonna give me rage? This guy's dead.
Ouch.
Nice. That was good. Right, Chocho. Right, we won that anyways. Round 11. Bad start for me.
I don't know why I did that.
And I died. No, I was unlucky. Alright, alright. I'm boost off. I got no stamina. What a beast. Alright. That should be enough. So we actually have enough time to look at the recording. Round 13. Very well done. Let me tell Spaniard.
That's honestly a bit absurd how Zanhu can dodge pretty much from anything.
Yeah, I mean, that's why he's so so strong and the best TV2 character.
And I literally can't do anything to you.
Yeah.
You can react to everything.
Yeah. It's Shugoki and Zanhu are the two is the best 2v2 character right now. And
no, I'm pretty sure Zanhu is better because you can pretty much react to anything.
No, I still call Nobu easily the best 2v2 character in the game at high level theoretically.
Theoretically.
Why is she better than everyone else again?
Because GB for bleeds. GB for bleeds are pretty much uncounterable for the most part if played right. But I mean, nobody's really going to do that like a lot of the time, but if played right, that's...
No, we play terribly.
No, you didn't. Yeah. You had some good moments. I definitely.
Yeah, some maybe like two.
Well, was
just the two against a guy who's insanely inhuman.
What's that? Well, it was
also
going to be a lot.
Also, I didn't done a lot of the team damage because I didn't like this guy.
I almost had a headbutt kill, but he kept interrupting me.
So there were some good moments there, but you. So I guess the issue is when you're fighting an opponent like Normie, who's got so much experience in this, is that you're thinking you go for peel attempts, and Normie is thinking what two steps ahead. And is then waiting for your peel attempt and is going to punish your peel attempt. So I saw that a few times. You like did a four dodge heavy to punish him going for a punish on the gut on the ward, but then he parried your four dodge heavy because he wasn't going to do his punish. That kind of thing.
Is there anything that we could have done against 1v1 in Normie? I don't think so.
I mean, your variable timed heavies are about the safest thing to do. Like, you've got chip damage on them.
They're still reactable.
Can you react to the...
They're really reactable.
Yeah, they're very reactive.
They're super reactable.
Yeah, so are Hito's.
Hito's are still really reactable.
Sensor hardest, but...
Yeah, Sensor. Sensor really tough.
The swing animation. Or the parry flash.
Okay, I'm a bit lost on finding the recording right now. But we'll figure it out. Yeah, I mean, you guys had a really good team comp with Worldward Shook.
Yeah, but I know me specifically blocked a lot with my health bar, so that wasn't really helping.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of hard to not block with your health bar with the Zanhu. There's insane range with insane damage.
Yeah, I know that one unblockable that you threw that I couldn't do anything because I was, you know, stuck between those Shugo and Zanhu thighs.
All right, I have found the recording. Victory. Okay. Let's switch over to that. Here, what is this? Let me know if you can see it.
Yep, I will. Yeah.
Okay, so I don't need sound. All right, so.
Ooh.
There is actually a lot of moments that, like, right as they happened, I was like, oh, I can't wait to talk about this.
No, not.
Yes, we're going to get the king shamed.
No. I was going to go for
this
longer.
This is also, we're doing this as a, there's no, like, shame. Obviously, it's not shame to be out a little bit outmatched when you're playing against Normie, and Edge did quite a good job as well, but, you know, he's much experienced. But the point about this is to demonstrate, demonstrate concepts, not so much to maybe it's not a tournament environment, don't worry about it. That there was,
I mean, in this case, punishes I'm doing, they would have probably worked with characters with non recoveries like this, but I kept forgetting the Zanhu is a thing.
But, yeah.
You know, there's plenty of things where it's like when explaining peel to people, it seems like, from my perspective, it seems like it's a bit hard to like explain it properly. But when you watch it happen, it's like, this is really just like another instinct that you have as a player, you know, saving your teammate.
Try maybe using the metaphor of like actually peeling a banana. That could work for some people.
I wouldn't, man. Peeling in front of is much simpler than peeling a banana. We're going to watch this. I'm going to only point out certain things that I think are important because we don't have all the time in the world here. But you'll see that I'm mostly locked on to whoever is fighting my teammate, obviously, to peel, like right there. Really important thing. Let me get to it as well. So here I saw the Shugoki getting on my teammate. So I dodged away from the other guy to hit stun the Shugoki and then got in position for a heavy that could peel as well. So it's all about positioning, really. Here I managed to get a lucky zone, killed the Warlord, and was
and up I
to
couldn't do anything. On...
Yeah, I mean,
yeah, it's so Shugoki. When you're in these scenarios, you need to think about, like, you could even, doesn't matter where the opponent is on the, obviously you want to externally guard if you can, but certain attacks will if you're, so this is a big, an important concept, if you are blocking the direction an attack comes in, you will block that attack regardless of whether it's externally or not. So, you know,
I know this.
So the zone, so for example, when you know Nabushi's zone attack and Jianhu's zone attack, they both come from the same side. They're both right attacks. So you want to be guarding, holding your default, you'll guard it on their left, like all the time in this scenario, because you just can't, they're not, their peel, if you're not, you know, in a recovery, you're going to be blocking that direction and you're going to be safe with it. So here, the Nabushi had like got blown up and Normie did a really good job of Nabushi did a really good job as well, positioning herself behind Normie the whole time.
Yeah, so here, actually, I'll put the sound on, you might hear. Actually, wait, no, I forgot I turned that off. So basically here, I saw him get blown up, like right here, and I was like, all right, slow down and try to stay behind me. That's why you're going to see him, me getting in the way and him positioning himself behind me. And I'm here just trying to stay as close as I can to him while also being able to hit both targets, which I did. That's why I went really aggressive here to make sure he can't get in on my teammate while he was just trying to dodge around, hidden stance, whatever. So there we got the kill on one guy. And remember, I think I just killed you here. Yeah.
Nabushi here being wise to not add tags and just let him want. He's got a big health advantage, so you don't need to add in extra tags if he's doing well in a 1v1. Just faint indicator in the background and yeah, gank without feeling revenge.
So that was actually a really good round there with showcasing how if you're low HP, you should just hang back, because they were really hungry to kill him, but they couldn't because I was around. Here is I was really good showcase of what we said earlier with guard breaking one guy and reading that they're going to try to peel and counter the peel. Here I ate a bunch of damage.
There we saw the wall light parry Normie and the Goki. What, like, I don't know if you would coordinate that, but you headbutted the Nabushi as well to allow wall to get his full punish.
Here I'm really low, just dodging away from the Shugoki. I couldn't really try to peel because I was low and I was just gonna eat something. So I keep dodging away, I keep parrying externally or dodging ahead, but if I can. And now here I am in a bit better situation in terms of positioning, because my teammate can hit both of them if needed. And I can focus a bit on the 1v1 and see if I can react to a headbutt like that and initiate offense easier.
That dodge cancel there, you saw why Nabushi, why his zone is such a good peel tool, because he's got dodge cancels, recovery cancels on it. Can't be punished by that headbutt. What you could have done then, though, as a Goki, was to dodge and just go for a regular guard break, because the recovery on the zone without doing the dodge cancel is not amazing. And of course, the dodge cancel all put yourself in some guard break recovery. Good there, getting the extra damage off that. Landing on the
demon ball,
that's the word. Sorry, I know what I want to say, I'm just bad at the words.
All right, so here, as you saw, I'm low, I'm under one bar, but I get a light parry. I could be greedy, try to get in the punish and hope that my teammate peels, or I could be safe about it, get a bit less damage, but get better positioning from it. Okay, the thing is dying.
Yeah, you light parried me.
Yeah, hold on, it's kind of dying. Yeah. It has moments. There we go. Light parried you and dodged away from the Shugoki. I got a bit of a punish in and I still died because I was way too low. This is actually the round we lost.
I was hoping my teammate here would try to do a poke, mini poke, so I can get a hit.
Yeah, it's... Yeah. I didn't expect the ganks to happen, really, so I didn't bother about being like... Because I'm not going to put you go gank practice before the 2v2. Yeah, no, man. So it's whatever there.
I mean, actually, I thought you guys did pretty well with your ganking, and that you were kept. You just let most time. It was a health advantage. You just let them 1v1, which is actually a really sensible way to do a gank. If there's no time pressure here, you don't need to kill the person before, you know, they get an ally rotating on them because their ally's dead. Just onesie with friends, and you can there to peel if they get light punish, you know, big way, but.
So in the situation like this, where they have health advantage, I'm going to want to either be a bit more safe or either, you know, split in a 1v1 where I can actually do something like I did not there, and then I threw, but so that happens.
The dodge into guard break was a good thing to hear. That was unfortunate. You saw he had revenge flashing, and that was actually what ended up losing you this round, because if you had let him hold revenge, you go, Ibushi doesn't have the best chase, you both could have, like, fucking got the hell out of dodge.
The play there was, obviously, the revenge pop knocked the Warlord down. Warlord was dead. Play, Shugoki should have ran to the other side of and stay in a corner.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to take a revenge fight. If you did that, you would have... I'm 90% sure you would have won the fight because you had like 4 bars of HP while the guy had 1. So
he just pressed to the res, right?
Yeah.
I wasn't sure if the Hawk would revenge lock that as well. Like
the time it. Yeah. No, there's very few attacks in the game now. I don't know if there's any attacks that revenge lock whilst the opponent's holding a bar of revenge. That just doesn't happen.
Hug revenge locks until the back break happens.
Yes, so you can get damage beforehand, but you can't get damage after. Basically, the rule is if they get damage, then they can pop revenge. So you don't get 2 hits if they're holding revenge, you just don't get 1 hit. And that's whatever the, you know. It would have made sense, so if you do a side heavy on the hug, that does more damage, so that is actually a good thing to do, but even if you interrupt the hug, but if you wait for the hug to do damage, you're not getting any more. That was there. See, the peel attempt went for the external deflect.
Can you go back on that?
Yes, I can. Here.
So the Goki peeled with a light, and Normie was baiting that, waiting for that, went use the deflect dodge recovery cancel to get
do more damage.
Threat on it, so which is really nice.
Yeah. It's just using your kit as much as you can.
Yeah.
Here I was trying to get close to my teammate so I can get in better position to peel. It's not that big of a deal for our two characters because we both have insane range.
And huge hitboxes.
Yeah, and huge hitboxes, so...
So actually, see? I think... I'm not sure if you were like doing this consciously, but you were doing quite a good job of Nobushi and Zhanhu, especially... Well, Nobushi especially, were making sure the Warlord's worst aspect in 2v2s is he doesn't have... great, like, he's not very mobile, so he kind of wants to be in the middle, like, in the edge. He's got good hitbox with his zone, he can go a long way, but, you know, he can't really catch up to a fight if it's going away from him. That was good there, external crush encounter. So you kind of, like, were doing quite well, and Goki's similar as well, actually, to just sort of try and pull them apart a little bit as a team call, and use your superior mobility on both of these characters to force them into positions where they can't. So right now, like, so if you pause it just there for a second.
Here, actually, right? Yeah.
Goki and the Warlord are now, they're too far away to peel from each other. Like, they can't, I mean, maybe the Warlord can with his zone a bit, but he's such low health. You've positioned themselves far enough apart that both of you can attack, both of the Bushi and the Zhanhu can attack either of them. And their allies probably not going to be able to get in close enough to, at least in that instant, to be able to peel. I mean, they will if they can dodge closer and then get closer. But right then, that was a good positioning by the Zhanhu and Bushi to force that situation where you have a free attack.
Right. So, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, because part of this is not, you need to know your own peel. You also need to know the peel that your opponents can do. And when you have an opportunity to attack for free, comparatively for free, because you can't be peeled and your ally can peel for you and they can't peel for their ally, their opponent, then you go, that's when you want to attack. So that's the best, you know, you attack when it's safe for you to attack and try and manufacture scenarios where you're going to be safe in order to attack, like they did there.
Right. I think I wanted to point out here is what we talked about with. We got a lot of damage on the Warlord, and he's right now. He's either I wasn't sure because the noble killed him in the end, but he was either 1 HP or bleeding out completely. We completely ignored the Warlord from here on, or not ignored, but stopped worrying about him. We moved on to the Shugoki. He was still there, and we only killed him when he put himself in recovery. We didn't worry about him unless that happened. So that's really important there. And here we just tried to, I just tried to put pressure because my teammate was out of stamina.
Yeah, now there's the danger of putting yourself in any kind of recovery. Even if you've got a hyper armor follow up to trade with it, and what the hell to trade with it? Not a trade you can make.
Yep.
But that was a very difficult scenario there for the Goku to be in, really. It's, you know, in a scenario where they're not, where your opponents aren't feeding revenge and you have a health advantage, there's not much you can do.
Yeah, good GB. Good GB from the
world here. Catch the recovery, yeah.
Here, there, I peeled for my teammate again. I ate 10 damage, but I dealt 32 in peeled, so that was a worth trade. Here, they were focusing me a bit more, so I went a bit more defensive until they went back to the Nobu. Where, I think we lost this. No, they gave me revenge here. Now, very important here, you saw as soon as I got a guard break on the Warlord, my teammate instantly locked onto the other guy. This guy right here, this moment, dead. My teammate has to peel off the other guy while I kill him, which he did. He died for it, but I still have revenge and Shigoki in a matchup versus a player that can react is.
What can you do for against Normie on react? He's very good at reacting. Well, certainly what you shouldn't do is throw a 600 unfeintable attack. So
yeah,
just a tip. Zone 2v2s, 1v1.
Here we had a bit of a bad start with taking a bit of damage. And pretty of poor positioning. Got a good heavy in there, and I started watching out for the Warlord a bit more because he was fucking with my teammate. All right, so here my teammates got an out, kind of. Got an away from the Shigoki. And we kind of got it more even because of that. So they had health advantage, now we're basically in the same situation with one low and one high HP. Yeah, that was unlucky timing with the bleed.
Can you just roll back where you killed the Warlord real quick?
It's okay, dying again. Give me a sec. Yeah, say what are you gonna say?
So here you can see I'm throwing a neutral heavy, but that was a mess up from me because I wanted to do the full block thing, and the full block heavy, which would have been quicker. And probably would have saved me there.
Oh, from what I'm seeing here, I think it would have traded. From what I just saw happen. It's a bit faster, but it's not big of a difference. From what it looks like here, it looks like you would have hit me, but you would have still eaten the heavy. So
no, I think that would have been... I think that would have been similar method, I think, so I think that would have been fine.
We lose one and then we win the last one.
I think you lose two, right? It ended up 10-3, I think.
Oh, we're that bad. I get it.
We did terrible.
I mean, you didn't do terrible. My teammate did great. And me being me, not being not supposed to be in a game like this. Here we had a really rough start with both of us being half HP or under. I got a bit greedy, should have been more defensive.
1 second.
I think I eat a garbage or something here, I don't remember.
The ward was doing really. The ward was doing really well there to push Normie back and keep him away from. The Goki was 1v1 was going well against Nabushi because that's a very. Nabushi is not a 1v1 hero. She's quite weak. 1v1s, and so the ward was doing well
to keep Normie away from her so he couldn't peel for her, and then let the Goki have that 1v1, which the Goki won. So this is what you sort of, again, the importance of peel, because he was peeling for his teammate by keeping him away. That throw was really bad.
Yeah, I know. To a data zone.
I get why you threw, because it put me out of stamina, and that could have been good if your teammate peeled the other guy. I don't remember. Did you eat damage during the throw?
Yeah, I did.
It was like somewhere here. Yeah, you threw him. I did a bunch of damage to you. I was wrong then. My bad. There, I think one of the plays could have been to actually Demon Ball, even if you would have eaten like 30 damage from me, because your teammate could have dealt like a lot, like 80 or upwards of that in damage, because Demon Ball is a fair move.
Yeah. So, like, a lot of the time you have to think about these 2v2s as, and in general, in Dominion as well, it's helpful to think about it's a battle of resources. You know, you're getting the damage. Sorry, you have, each team has a certain amount of resource that they can spend on, you know, on fighting, and that's their health and their renown, their points, and so on. And if you put yourself in a situation where you as an individual are going to take more damage than you deal out, but your teammate is going to be able to get more damage, and the whole total interaction gives your team more damage on the opponents, and you have health to spare, then that's a good thing for you to do. And you know, it's about spending your resources where you can make them work most effectively for you. I don't know if that made any sense.
Yeah, it's you have health, you can afford to do things, you gotta be careful. That's it.
But like, yeah, if your teammate does, if you end up taking more damage, but your teammate does even more damage, so you know, the whole interaction ends up being like 30 health for 50 health, for example. If you can afford that without dying yourself, then that's something you can go for. Puts you in a better position overall.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, that has ended. We've finished that. The bang on 3 o'clock for me, which is the end of the Dojo session. So, any more questions we have, or Blitz, you want to add anything that we haven't probably covered?
Buff Warlord when?
Yeah, next patch, hopefully.
Tune down the Zanhua bit.
I'd nerf the damage on his unblockables. Other than that, I think he's fine.
Well, yeah, like
the only thing that really annoys me is his dodge into dodge.
I mean, that's fine. That's just you should guard break. It's not like the end of the world. It's but I do think his heavies are, especially because he has winner's advantage as well. You can get those heavies to deal like 37, and that's not okay. I think those should be tuned down to like 27, maybe.
The finishes, I think they probably end up being like...
Well, I mean, he can easily win them now.
Aren't they 39?
Oh, with the winner's advantage, it can be up to 39, yeah.
Yeah.
But most finishes aside unblockables are 30 damage. So Zhanhu...
I mean, with how accessible they are for Zhanhu, I don't know.
Maybe slightly low, like, you know.
Yeah, I think 27 would be as low as I'd put them, but...
It will be a very big damage left. I mean, I think that'll probably be a bit too much.
I mean, I think they're like the best unblockables in the game. Like some of the best.
I think they are, they're good because
I don't know if I'd rank that above BP's unblockable.
I definitely would.
Loves and Chain Raider Fury Zone.
I mean, I definitely would put them again above BP's. I mean, BP's.
There's so many positioning things you can get with BPs.
Just because it has a really big hitbox? Like, what's so good about
it? And you can't with Zhanhu? I don't get it.
No, his is just like a lot slower than BPs would be. So it's like easier to dodge.
Yeah, but there's so much less range, and it is still a bit of a smaller hitbox.
I wouldn't say they're the best
because...
And BPs can be used from neutral. These have to be chained, which I feel like is also a pretty big plus.
Goki's fully charged have even more damage and even more range. And also, I think people are sleeping. 36. People are sleeping on JJ at the moment. JJ's finisher heavies have just dummy range, dummy damage. They got they're two less damage, and he has deadly instead of winner's advantage, and he doesn't have accessible openers. But they, I think, and he's got recovery cancel as well into Sifu, so you know, he's similar levels of safety. And they have lower recovery normally. In fact, they got fucking basically zero recovery on the hit or miss. So you just can't punish them. So I think JJ, people are sleeping on JJ because Janhu is so good at the moment, but I think JJ and unblockables are there with Janhu's.
I mean, yeah, you can chain two unblockables on JJ with Sifu, like Sifu zone and then heavy.
I mean, that's very nice, but just in terms of like the attack itself. Yeah. Finishes super good, so but yeah, they're 30 damage, so you like,
yeah, I'd call Zahn's the best though,
yeah,
they're easier to get,
yeah, and like JJ suffers from other things. If he had like enhanced lights, for example, he'd be one of the best 2Z characters in the game, I'd say, but he doesn't quite have that.
That was about it for today.
Yeah, I wouldn't think anything more. Thanks very much for everybody for joining. Any other questions?
No, all right.
Not really.
Good.
Well, yeah, Peel, the most important skill to have in Forerunner, in team fight modes. It's the fundamentals of team fight modes. So,
other than blocking, maybe.
Well, blocking.
I mean, you have a health buff on that.
Peel.
We only covered it for 2 hours, but like we can carry on going at it. You'll see if you think about it, you will see it everywhere. If you're watching any high level play, or even just like in a mid level play, but I think the big thing to think about if you're applying it to your own games is to. Like, don't let your allies get punished if you can avoid it. I've definitely been in a situation in matchmaking where I've been guard broken by a peacekeeper, and my ally has just fucking stood there and watched me get stabbed 3 times. Don't be that person. Pay attention to what your allies are experiencing.
Yeah. Peel is, like I said, just a basic instinct that you're going to have as a player. This is just telling you how to do it properly, and you know, use that as fullest.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much, Nomi, for showing us all that. Everybody, no for joining. I need to go to bed. So, GG's, guys.
Peace.
Goodbye.
Have a good one, guys.
So what's going to be like in the next lesson I'm going to teach?
We don't know.
We don't know yet.
Have suggestions or anything you're particularly interested in, just put it in the Dojo General and we can look at it. Like, it's the same we did the 1v1 workshop the guy particularly asked to, although I don't think he actually showed up for that, so but we can do something like that again if you're whatever you're interested in, be like go a particular feats or something like that.
Right, well I'm gonna be out.
Yeah. Later, bye guys.
Bye. Anybody here plus for twosies?
All right.
No, dude, it's 4 a.m., dude. I need to go to sleep.
Okay, then. I might be up to.
Ooh, all right. Let's find another. I'll tell my buddy.